Topic is a story, which is a little short story, but it connects with quite a essential topic in Buddhism, which is how we take care of ourselves and others. And it's always been a discussion amongst people that I know who study Buddhism that we know what is or sometimes people who, let me put it this way, people who come to the center, right? They will sometimes wonder if they, if they will meet people, and they will, those people will say, "I come to the temple to do good karma. It's good for my life." And it sounds weird for us because in our Western tradition, we are often used that religion must be for the other, and we cannot simply do something for ourselves. For this reason, that's maybe interesting to look a little bit at what is the real, how does Buddhism look at the idea of being selfish or being altruist? To start with this, let me just begin with a very controversial quote straight away. It could also be useful to show the actual quote, so if I may be able to share, use the sharing function, maybe the host would allow me to. It would be helpful. But in any case, I can read it for you, and then you can also hear it.
I think you should be able to do that now, huh?
Okay, let me try. Yes. And then I found out that the PowerPoint is not on yet. Okay, here it is. One more moment. And there it is. I hope this time I have not left in any Dutch. Because often these things I've been teaching in Dutch before, and then I translate it to English. Sometimes I translate it back and forth a couple of times until no one understands what it means. Okay, this is my life. I teach in different languages, and sometimes I forget myself what language I originally used to speak. Okay, so this is a picture, a very ancient historical picture. Well, not very ancient, but old. Do you know what it is? It's an acrobat, traditional Indian acrobat. And he will climb onto a pole, and then he will hang on the pole. Okay? We'll come back to that in a moment as to how that is relevant in any way. This is a sec this is the controversial quote that I was going to mention. So don't sacrifice your own welfare for that of another, no matter how great. Realizing your own true welfare, be intent on just that. So when we read this quote from our Western perspective, I'm just presuming that most of the people logging in today are from a Western background, okay? I don't know exactly, but at least the people I'm seeing now. So this looks a bit selfish. It looks a bit strange. It doesn't look like a good intention for many people. But there is a meaning here that is very deep and profound, and it deals with the way we look at life. So let's look at what it means and how it relates to meditation. To begin this story, we need to go back to the time of the Buddha. At that time, the Buddha was about to enter Nirvana. And do you know what that means when the Buddha enters Nirvana? What do I mean by that?
Like sort of like heaven or something, enlightenment.
Enlightenment. But the Buddha was already enlightened.
Isn't it when a soul stops reincarnating?
Yes, you can say that. So when the Buddha comes at the end of his life, they will call that the final nirvana. So there's two kinds of nirvana. The nirvana, which we call normally in common English, enlightenment, which is the awakening to your true potential. And that is the awakening to and overcoming greed, hatred, and delusion, the limitations of the mind. And when a Buddha, or any enlightened person for that matter, comes at the end of his life, they will not be reborn, but they will enter into final nirvana. It's not usually described as a heaven, but more like a state beyond all description. But let's go back to the story. So this was almost at the end of the life of the Buddha. The life of the Buddha had just announced, because wise people, they will know when they are about to die. So the Buddha had just announced that he would be dying in 3 months. You know, when wise people, they are at the end of their lives, they will usually know when they're dying. Even doesn't have to be very enlightened monks or nuns, could also be simply wise people in your environment, in your everyday life that you meet. Sometimes they will know when they are about to die. But usually they will know it not so long beforehand. But the Buddha, he knew it in advance. We even know, for example, for Martin Luther King, that he knew that he was about to be killed in advance. So these are people who might have some wisdom and they know about their own demise. But the Buddha, he knew it 3 months in advance. But to come back to why I'm telling this story, there was one monk whose name was Attadattha. Attadattha was a monk who was not really a group kind of person. So when his friends heard that the Buddha was about to pass away within 3 months, they therefore thought that, well, we have to follow him for the last 3 months. Wherever he's going, whatever he's doing, we will try to follow him. And that's exactly what they did. But one of them opted out. His name was Attadatta. He opted out. He said to the others, I'm not going to follow the Buddha. And they criticized him for not being loyal to the Buddha. But then he went to his hut and he decided to meditate for these 3 months very intensively, with much commitment, I mean. I mean, you can't really meditate intensively. If you do so, you're probably not doing it right. But with intensively, I mean with much commitment throughout the day, spending many hours on meditation as we do in a retreat. So that's what he did. And then people came to criticize him because he did not follow the Buddha. He merely stayed in his hut to meditate. And the Buddha then heard about those rumors that he might not be loyal to his own teacher. So he had Attadatta call to him. Now it should be said that sometimes the Buddha does this not because he is in doubt, but because the community is in doubt. So he wants to clear things up. Just like a judge might call many witnesses, or sorry, just like a prosecutor might call witnesses to the stand to clear something up that wouldn't be sufficient for him to say it himself. So the Buddha, he simply was like a person who wanted to clear this up. So he had Attadatta come forward and into the community. In the midst of the community, he asked Attadatta, why did you choose for the last 3 months not to follow me? And then Attadatta said, I have been practicing myself with much commitment in the past weeks to meditate for myself, because I knew that if I would follow you, I would be able to listen to your teachings. But if you are about to pass away, I might not be able to spend much time asking you questions about meditation. And then when you pass away, I will not have the time to do so anymore. I will not have the opportunity to do so anymore. So I just want to make sure that I have no more questions left, and the opportunity for me to ask you questions still exists now. So I've dedicated myself fully to meditation. That's why me not following you is not a lack of loyalty, but rather a dedication to what you have taught. So the Buddha, he praised Attadattha. And he said, he talked about this this difference between taking care of yourself and taking care of others in many places. So in this case, the Buddha, the monk, Attadattha, he chose for himself. He chose not to be socialized for the last 3 months with the other monks and the Buddha. But he dedicated himself fully to meditation because he knew full well that he might not be able to have another chance to ask questions and ask the Buddha to help him progress on the path. And eventually he attained enlightenment because of his heedfulness, as we say it. Heedfulness here meaning that he reminded himself of the true purpose of humankind. So let's go back to what I'm talking about today, which is taking care of yourself and others. We often have conflicts in our life between those two things. Sometimes we feel that we are not taking care enough of ourselves. Sometimes other people might feel that we are not taking care enough of them, that we might be self-absorbed. This is a balance that is difficult to accomplish. So, how do we maintain this balance, right? This is what I'd like to talk about a little bit today, because the story of Attadattha is already finished. So today is a very small story, but a big topic. So let us go to talk about this. The Buddha said in a very small little text, but nonetheless very important. He said there's four kinds of people in the world. Those who neither provide benefit to themselves nor others. A person who neither provides benefit to themselves nor to others. A person who is providing benefit to themselves, who's not providing benefit to themselves. Who's, in other words, in common English, who's not taking care of themselves, but do take care of others. Another person is taking care of themselves, but not others. And then the fourth person, a person taking care of themselves and others. Of these four, the Buddha said, the last one, the dark green one, is the best, taking care of yourself and others. So when we notice, let's study these in more detail. The first one, to neither provide benefit to yourself nor others, is just like certain plants and trees destroy themselves by their own fruit. This is a comparison, a metaphor that the Buddha used. Some people, they make mistakes in their life and they destroy themselves in the process. Just like some plants or trees in the time of the Buddha, actually some types of bamboo, they destroyed themselves by their own fruit. So the fruit that came from the bamboo would destroy the tree, would destroy the bamboo tree. This is quite odd, but it happens in nature. And then there is also another example that we can mention. So this is the sort of thing that the Buddha refers to when he's talking about, for example, a criminal, a person who is hurting themselves and others a lot. This is something who we call, someone who we call neither providing benefit to themselves nor to others. In this context, it's useful to notice that one king once made an observation to the Buddha, and the Buddha, he said, that is a very correct observation, that a person who is hurting another person actually hurts themselves. Because the people who, when we are not taking care of the other, we actually hurt ourselves. We are not taking care of ourselves in the process. So there's one anecdote of a Tibetan monk who was shown an exhibition of all the cruelties that had happened during the Second World War. Anyone from a Jewish background here? No, maybe somebody. And in this context, that meant that was a very honest exhibition showing all the cruelties that happened in the concentration camps. And somebody asked the Tibetan monk, does it remind you of what you have gone through, the cruelties which happened in Tibet? And does it, do you feel sorry for the Jews? And he said very wisely, I feel very sorry for the Jews, but I even feel more sorry for the Nazis, which was a very surprising statement, and perhaps even controversial for us to hear. But what he meant by that is that, and he explained it, is that he knew that the Jews would simply, after a while, their suffering might cease, might stop after the Second World War. But the Nazis who had committed all these cruelties, they would forever be haunted by the cruelties that they had done. And according to Buddhist belief, the things that we do not only follow us in this life, but also in the next. Whereas some suffering that might occur in our lives right now might not repeat itself at all in the next life. So in this case, the Tibetan monk made a very wise response to that statement, to that exhibition. So in a similar note, King Pasenadi also said that a person hurting another actually hurts themselves. So King Pasenadi used to be quite a violent king, but he eventually became more, he kind of mellowed out during the process when he encountered Buddhism. But he always remained a bit of an angry person though, but he kind of mellowed out a lot. Because of these intelligent conversations that he had with the Buddha. The second kind of person is somebody who doesn't provide benefit to themselves, but does to others. This is sometimes, I think, a bit cynically called in English language the Mother Teresa syndrome, or which is sometimes even called as used for some psychological conditions. Although controversially so. This is like somebody taking care of many other people but not taking care of themselves. I don't believe that Mother Teresa was necessarily such a person, but this is just the term that they use. Anyway, it means that some people in life, they do not take care well for themselves, but they like to gain happiness, derive their happiness fully from taking care of others. That may be from their family and their children. Many mothers, they derive most of their happiness in life from taking care of their children. But unfortunately, children grow up and one day we have to let them go. And where do we then derive our happiness from? This is sometimes called the empty nest syndrome. When we, another syndrome, sorry, I am from a psychological background, sorry. So the empty nest syndrome is not really a psychological disease. It sounds worse than it is. It's simply a feeling of emptiness that some people experience when their children leave their house, when their children grow up and they go to live for themselves. So, however, there is an observation in the time of Kunyai Ajahn. Do you remember Kunyai? Kunyai, the founder of our temple, the nun who founded our temple. Our temple was founded by a nun. Did you know that? And Kunyai, she once had a woman coming to her complaining that her children would not, her child, her, I think it was a son, didn't listen to her. And then it turns out that when Kunyai asked about it more, it turns out that actually the son had already become quite mature now. He was a grown-up man. And so Kunyai told her that it's time for her to realize that the child had grown up, the son had grown up now. And just like a little bird that leaves its nest eventually to go its own way, sometimes a parent, always, not sometimes, always a parent needs to let go of his or her children at a certain moment in time. So Kunyai said, you have only not so many years left. You are an old woman now, and you should spend your time to think about yourself, to take care of yourself, your own spiritual well-being. And in that way, she could be a refuge to others as well, by people would easily find spiritual solace in her if she only take more care of herself rather than always running after others. So in some case, some people, not only lay people, even some monks, they take a lot of care of other people. They teach everyone, take care of everyone, call all the lay people, how are you doing? They sometimes forget to take care of themselves. It can happen. We all are still human. So therefore, even monks, we have to make sure that we are not mistaken about this. Because the Buddha, he put this at number two. That means that he thinks that number three, even though more selfish, is still better than not taking care of yourself at all. So the third one is taking care of yourself, but not others. And in this case, the Buddha, he said, that is even actually better. Because even though it's selfish, but you don't forget yourself. And that's very important. Of course, simply deriving happiness from taking care of others is a good thing. But we should not forget that it should be part of a process in which we also take care of ourselves. The other people might not always be grateful, and they might not always appreciate our help. So we should ask ourselves today, when we are helping another person, would we still feel happy if they are not grateful? Would we still feel happy if they cannot return the favor? Would we still be happy if they don't appreciate it? Sometimes we can then teach ourselves in this way and find out whether the goodness that we do is sometimes still connected with a need inside of us. It's still good to be altruistic, take care of others. But we should also learn to find what our needs are and take care of ourselves as well. So this is a story. This is a picture which is quite funny, kind of funny. This woman is looking for a lost puppy. And she looks in every place and puts all these pamphlets everywhere, but then she forgot that she actually sat on it. She hadn't noticed. So this is, of course, not a real picture, but it's just, a Photoshop compilation. So we sometimes tend to look outwards because our eyes, by their very nature, look outwards. So we look for our happiness outwards as well, but we forget that happiness can also be found inside. So in the story of Attadattha, it is quite clear that he thought of following the Buddha as would be simply taking care of others, taking care of the Buddha, being a loyal student, but it would not be a good way to take care of themselves. And the Buddha eventually would always say, take care of yourself and you will be a refuge for others. These are some pictures from the story, but I'll go through them now. The third one is still not perfect, but at least we don't forget ourselves. Because in Buddhism it said, if you provide benefit to yourself but not to others, it's not perfect, but it's the start. Why is it of utmost importance to train yourself first in life, to take care of yourself spiritually? It's similar to the prescription that is, or sorry, the instruction that is normally given when you are in an airplane. What do they always say when they give instructions before the airplane takes off as related to yourself and others, with regard to yourself and others?
To put on your own life preserver thing, whatever they call it, before you try to help other people.
Exactly. Yes. So this is, of course, also holds for our lives to some extent. We can only really be there for another person if we have also spent some time taking care of ourselves. It's a cliche, but it's an important reminder, which is why I tell the story of today. And there's other stories. If I have time, I will tell you in a moment. So it's of utmost importance to train ourselves first. We can only train ourselves, though, by ourselves. In Buddhism, we do believe very strongly that there is no one else in life that can be a real refuge to us as we can ourselves. The Buddha, he said, we are our own refuge, attahi atanonato. That means that no one really can be a refuge to ourselves except for ourselves. Of course, I understand that this flies in the face of some other religious doctrine in other religions, but maybe it doesn't, I don't know. So the Buddha is seen as a teacher. The Buddha is a refuge as well. But the Buddha is a refuge only in the sense that we have him as an example. Not in the sense, well, help me, Buddha, help me. No, it's not like that. So he even said himself, the Buddha has only showed the way, but you have to walk yourself. It is, so therefore it's actually, in the end, it's the more direct way to train yourself by yourself is the most easiest and direct. Also, there's a more fundamental reason why taking care of yourself is not wrong, as long as we have a motivation to also be there for other people and when we have taken care of ourselves. That is, but sometimes we have to realize that, as we say in Buddhism, we are born alone and we also die alone. This is a common statement in Thai Buddhism. We are born alone and we die alone. We cannot take anyone with us, right? That would sound very creepy, right? If you are about to die, you say, can you go with me? But we are also born alone, normally. Unless you are a twin, but you get what I mean. Even if you are a twin, you know, eventually you only can take care of your happiness and suffering, and no one else can take care of you as much as yourself. So that's why it's said in Buddhism that a good teacher should establish in himself first in what he's teaching to others. And it's also said that it's good in the spiritual matters, it's always good to start with yourself. But the highest is always, when we go further, the highest goal is always to take care of yourself and others. Why is it then that sometimes people are selfish? Is that a good thing then? No, of course not. So what does Buddhism say about selfishness? In Buddhism, selfishness is not thinking about yourself. That is in itself not wrong. But when we are thinking about ourselves and it becomes a self-absorption and we are not eager to love another person, we do not love other people. This is because of three reasons, as I already mentioned before, the three causes of suffering in life: greed, hatred, and delusion. For example, if you're really greedy for something, you really want to have something, it's very difficult to see the other person and to see their needs. When you really hate somebody, it's very difficult to see that they also want to be happy, just like you. And delusion is, of course, the worst. We simply are not aware that we are not really living for, that we're not really taking care of other people's happiness, because we are simply not aware of the differences between people. So, because of these three, we cannot really see what makes us happy and makes other people happy. That's why selfishness is never leading us to be happy with ourselves. So selfishness is a bit of a confusing word. And some people, like the Dalai Lama, have sometimes said that actually, in fact, there is a sort of intelligent selfishness. But I don't know about these words. It kind of becomes confusing if you say it that like that. So I prefer not to use that word. But I understand where he's coming from, because the Dalai Lama is simply saying that to take care of yourself in order to be able to be there for other people more is a good thing. So in that is what he meant. Sometimes we are taking care, we think we are taking care of ourselves, but we use delusion, short-sightedness, and we use greed and hatred, and then we make mistakes. Like this little man is making some fire, and he's using the logs, or using for his logs, for his fire, he's using the same, he's using the, what do you call it, the steps of his ladder as his logs for his little fire. In this way, he can never escape his prison. So in this way, sometimes we are short-sightedness because of greed, hatred, and delusion. That's what's so good about meditation. It takes care of greed, hatred, and delusion at its very roots. So at least these will have less of an expression in our character, because we develop other good qualities like clarity of mind, wisdom, and compassion. So the highest aim in Buddhism is described in the symbol of the two acrobats. So if you remember, as I was going to show you, this is the little acrobat, right, on the pole, right? Now in the time of the Buddha, there were two acrobats just like that. The Buddha, he used this as a metaphor. He said, there are two acrobats, a little young child, a little girl, and an older man, probably her uncle or maybe even her father, on the pole. Can you imagine what a difficult trick that is to do? And they do these two acrobats, they were not in a circus, but they were working together, just like what do you call it, street jugglers, street, what do you call it in English, like jugglers, or like people, street artists these days, right? Well, you know what I mean. We have many of those in Amsterdam. If you ever want to come and visit, I can show you some. Somebody's telling me already what it is in English. So okay, I can't read all the chat. Okay, all right, sorry, I'm just going back to the presentation. I will look at the chat later on. So in this case, the little girl must have been very strong, huh, to carry this man on her stick. I think I misremembered it. The man was holding the stick. It's the opposite of the picture. And the little girl was up on top of the stick, on top of the pole. And the man, he said to the little girl, "You know what? I take care of you and make sure that you are well balanced, and you make sure that I do my job right." And the little girl said, "No, no, no, we can't do that, uncle. We can't do that. That's not the right way. We never do it like that. You should take care of yourself, and I take care of myself. You make sure that you are properly holding the pole and that I'm not falling down. And I make sure that I'm holding the pole well and I'm not falling down. That way we can do the trick well and a lot of people will come to see us." And then the uncle said, "You have correctly understood what it means to be an acrobat." In other words, we are all acrobats of life. And if we sometimes find it hard to balance our own benefit and that of another person, we are not facing a new problem. It's a problem of more than 2,000 years old. And in this case, this is even symbolized by two acrobats, which are literally balancing. And so if we take care of ourselves, we can better take care of the other. Because in life, very often we are doing a sort of trick together, not a real trick, of course, we're not fooling anyone. But in a sense, we are trying to do this balance. We are dependent on each other in life. We cannot live in isolation. So sometimes we are living in this balance, and we have to make sure that we are properly taking care of ourselves, and in that way taking care of others. But we should also not forget to do the last step of taking care of others as well. So how do we take care of ourselves? Here you can see another picture, same acrobats. We do this by what they call Pavana Pakulikata, which means actually to develop, to do something consistently. This is often mentioned by our abbot as a very important term in Pali language. I've used the entire Pali phrase here, Asevanaya Pavanaya Paulikamena, which means that we practice ourselves mindfully and practice meditation and mindfulness consistently. And in that way, we have the balance needed to take care of others as well. We can easily hold the pole on which our other people, our loved ones, are sometimes holding themselves. We take care of the other. This is also from the same text, from the text of the two acrobats. And by patience, sometimes in the Chinese version of this text, it also says by forgiveness. Yeah. So there's a number zero as well. Forgiveness, patience, non-violence. We try not to hurt each other. If the other person's angry, don't respond in anger. The best advice you can give, right? If one person is angry in any marriage or relationship, it's not a big problem. But if two people are angry, that's a big problem. So choose the right time when you want to be angry. Then there is loving kindness. If we can tolerate the other person, it's also easier to see how they can be happy. And then in that way, we develop sympathy. You will notice maybe if somebody knows, is aware of this, this is the same term that Gandhi used for his non-violent campaigns. Avihimsa, yeah, he used the word ahimsa, it's the same word. So what this little text says that if we are to take care of others in this way, by patience, non-violence, loving kindness, and sympathy, we must first have the first one. Pavana, pahulikamena, which means to take care of ourselves and consistently. So in that way we can be patient and looking positively in life at other people. These are some reasons why we sometimes choose not to meditate and therefore find it hard to be consistent. I already mentioned this a few months ago. So there's 10 reasons not to meditate, right? I think you've heard them before. And the same exact same reasons can be used to meditate right now. So for example, if you're hungry, it's good to meditate because you feel light. But if you've just eaten, it's also good to meditate because you have energy. So there's always a good reason to meditate right now. But if we are to do a good job in meditating every day, we might set a certain time for ourselves that we meditate every day. And that is the easiest way. So I would like to finish with this concluding question. And you might want to take it home as a sort of homework. So you don't have to give an answer to me. Give an answer to yourself. Is taking care of yourself and the other person for you a different thing, or can they be combined? Does it feel the same to do something for yourself or the other? That may be a good reflection, which may be helpful in the process. So I'd like to close with this final question. Does anyone have any questions about this presentation?